Welcome back to the A to Z of Junior Golf Podcast. I'm joined by my co-host today, Ryan Burr. And for all your new listeners out there, my name is Aaron Zane. I'm 16 years old, and I train at the Sean Foley Performance Academy.
Certainly, this podcast is something that's important to you as our family, the Junior Golf family, continues to get bigger. Why did you decide to start this podcast?
I mean, I've been through tons of experience. I've been through the highs and the lows. And I just wanted to relate with the audience.
And certainly you can. Your highs as a very young player, you're one of the best in the country. And then you went through a very difficult time in your life. Tell me about the growth spurt. How much did you grow and how long?
Yeah, I grew 15 inches in 9 months, 15 months. So yeah, that was definitely hard to adjust to my new body and get used to swinging the golf club that way.
And 15 inches in 15 months. With that came a slump, but you're now back on top. Tell me about the last month of golf for Aaron Zhang.
My last month of golf, I had a third place, 2 second places, and a champion at the recent FJT at Victoria Hills. So I've been playing really good golf and just starting to get back to winning.
Yeah, no doubt about it. So you're back in the winner's circle, a couple second place finishes. But even in those finishes, you could see that better days were ahead. Tell me about some of your best rounds.
Well, my last tournament, which was the Orlando Junior Amateur, I started with a 74, but then I bounced back with 68, 69, which were the two lowest scores of the tournament.
Wow, so, that is impressive, Aaron. Yeah. And speaking of impressive, no one more impressive than the winner of the United States Open at Pebble Beach. He is our first guest tonight, the one and only major champion at the U.S. Open. He's Gary Woodland. Gary, thanks for joining us on the podcast. How'd you get started in this crazy game of golf?
He was sitting on the range trying to hit it as far as he could. You know, my mom would drop me off on her way to work in the morning during the summer and pick me up from the golf course on her way home, and then I'd go play baseball or basketball at night. So I was probably raised more by the golf professionals at my local club. As a kid, my mom just dropped me off. They probably drove them crazy, so sometimes she'd bring in donuts and bring in gifts to calm them down a little bit for having to deal with me all day. I loved being out there. I loved hitting balls. Didn't know how good I was, but I know I loved it. It's kind of helped me, I guess, get to where I am today.
Hey, Gary, thank you so much for joining us today on this podcast. Your story is inspiring to all of us. First question to you is, you know, you played so many sports as a young kid. When did you realize you could become really good at golf?
Not really until you know, I signed to play basketball my junior year in high school. I wasn't really recruited to play golf. My senior year in high school, after I'd already committed to play basketball, I started to win a little bit. I think I won 5 times my senior year in high school. I'm like, hey, maybe I am pretty good at this. The golf coach at Kansas at the time put a lot of time and energy into me and was very upset when I decided to go play basketball and told me I would change my mind because my future was in golf. And that kind of just stuck with me, to be honest with you. I played 1 year of basketball, loved it, but decided to make the change, and it was the greatest thing I ever did. And I realized, you know, when I got to KU, you know, growing up, I was always the best golfer around where I was. When I got to KU, I definitely was not the best golfer. So I had to step up my work ethic a little bit, step up my game, and it definitely pushed me and helped me to get to where I am, coming into somewhere where a situation where I had to work to get better.
Gary, you were a terrific junior player, but your big improvement came in college from sophomore to junior year when your scoring average dropped down from a 74 to a 69. How did you improve that much in 1 year?
You know, I made a big commitment. I started sacrificing the things I was doing, you know, maybe not having as much fun on the weekends. I made a big change to Randy Smith in Dallas, Texas. I went down and hired him as a swing coach, and he really changed my game tremendously. I'd had a local guy back home, and it was, to his credit, told me if I wanted to get to the next level, I needed to hire a big-time coach. I sought out Randy Smith, went down, spent some time with him, and he helped me, you know, eliminate the left side of the golf course where I was able to hit driver more and get the stinger shot so I was able to get the golf ball and play and really just teach me how to play golf. I was kind of an athlete out there just whacking the golf ball around down, and I'm forever grateful for him for that. And really then you started to get some confidence, and you know, in this game, anything, it's all based on, there's a lot of great golfers out there, but not everybody believes they can do it. When I started to see some results, I started to believe more and more, and the rest is history. I mean, I got out on the PGA Tour a year out of school, way too soon. I wasn't ready to be out there, but that was just the kind of confidence level that I had. I always believed I was going to make it. I always probably believed I was better than I was, and believed the sky was the limit. And I think when you have that kind of attitude and you're able to make the sacrifices and realize, okay, maybe I'm going out too much in college. Maybe I'm not practicing enough on this or that. And you're able to sit back and surround yourself with the right people. You can kind of understand that and say, okay, I need to get better here. I need to get better here. And if you continue to improve, great things will happen. And that's where my mindset was. That's where my goals aligned. I surrounded myself with the right people, and I was able to help me get to where I am today.
Now, great example of hard work paying off, Gary. Got a question that so many of our junior golfers that listen and watch this podcast want to know, which is, how do you stay mentally in the moment when a player, a junior golfer, is coming down the stretch? How do they not get ahead of themselves and think about the result? You obviously won the U.S. Open. Doesn't get any bigger than that. How'd you stay in the moment?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think the big thing, and I've asked that question myself, so it's a great question that you got to love young kids asking that. You know, the big deal for me is, and you talk to a lot of great people, and they talk about getting obsessed with your routine to forget about the results. And so when I'm practicing at home, and a lot of the practice I do, especially the preparation I do before I go out for a round, when I'm warming up, it's all routine-based. I count in my head when I swing. So I'm trying to count in my head to get obsessed with my routine to forget about the results. And I think that's huge, especially when you get under pressure. You know, my warm-up is the exact same me every day. I'm trying to make everything as simple as possible so I'm not thinking too much. And, you know, sometimes you can get out there and you think about the result, you know, and that's the last thing you need to do. So keeping that routine kind of puts you in the moment, and helps me stay in the moment, taking that extra deep breath. You know, I spent some time with Greg Norman and asked him, you know, and what he liked to do, left foot, right foot, you know, talk about things that are real to get his mind off everything else that he could not control. And I think that's a great way to look at it. I've talked to other athletes who really simplify things in big moments and tried to hone themselves in, you know, calm their breath down, to calm the heart rate down. You know, it's like you watch the great free throw shooters do the exact same thing every time because it's able to calm them down. And I think that's a huge lesson for kids. Sometimes they get so caught up, they get so moving a little too fast, whatever it is. Make sure that routine's the same. I remember as a kid, I went out and watched the Women's U.S. Open was in Kansas at Prairie Dunes. And I watched Annika Sorensen hit putts on the putting green. And it was a little beep timer. And she was just working on having the exact same time from her standing over the golf ball to hitting the golf ball every time. I mean, that's just one of the greatest women to ever play the game is working on her routine at a major championship. That's always hit home to me and something I've always tried to focus on.
Gary, I have another question for you. When junior golfers hit a bad shot, they tend to get easily frustrated. How do you deal with this frustration?
You know, and for me, when it comes to that, I always try to look at Tiger Woods. And it's one thing to get mad. It's another thing to get frustrated. You watch Tiger Woods. Tiger Woods, you never see him take a bad shot and it trickle over to another bad shot. And that's the problem when people get frustrated. When you get frustrated, it starts to linger. And all of a sudden, one bad shot turns into a bad hole, which turns into a bad nine, which turns into a bad round. That turns into a bad tournament. So it's a trickle effect. I'm not saying go out there and throw clubs and say bad words or whatever it is, but you have to find the one thing to allow you to get it out. Get over that golf shot, you know, whether it's you pinch yourself or whatever it is, you take a deep breath, you take a step back and realize that was one shot. The only thing that matters now is the shot in front of me. Me getting mad, me getting angry and negative is only going to – it's contagious. It's only going to trickle down and affect me even more. So if you watch Tiger Woods, Tiger Woods will get mad. Tiger Woods never lets that affect his next shot. He's the greatest to ever do it. I think that's the best example you can find.
Gary, I want to talk about your partnership with Wilson. They've won more major championships than any other brand with their irons. Why did you choose Wilson, and how's that been a good partnership?
It was important to me when I was partnering with a brand you know, I've been a sports guy my whole life. I wanted to partner with a sports brand. There's no better sports brand in the world than Wilson. From every sport, you talk about the football, the Super Bowl, you talk about college basketball, baseball, tennis, whatever you want to talk about, golf now. And, you know, Wilson, they won a major with their irons in every decade for the last 60 years. I think 62 majors in total. That's a brand you want to partner with. So I was excited to have the opportunity. Once I put the clubs, I was able to test them. It was a no-brainer for me. The irons fit me perfectly. We continue to work and continue to get more clubs into play. They want to be great. So for me, it was to win a major championship with the Wilson special.
Wow, Gary, that's truly amazing. Well, thank you once again for coming on to our podcast. We really appreciate having you. You know, your story is so inspiring to all of us, and how you started out in basketball and then had such a smooth transition into golf, and how your work ethic was just so good and it got you to where you are. So, you know, thanks once again and happy holidays.
You're the best, brother. Happy holidays. Stay safe. We'll see you soon.
Definitely Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to Gary Woodland, and exactly what you said. Thanks so much for coming on the podcast. Think about that, Aaron. He chose to play college basketball and then switches to golf. So I got to ask you, if you switch from golf in college to play a college sport, what are you picking?
Good question, Ryan. Honestly, I'd pick football. I mean, my mom would never allow that. But yeah, I've always just loved football. I'm quarterback.
Quarterback? Can throw it pretty good?
Yeah.
All right. Well, hey, listen, we'll have to get you out there on the football field and maybe a football podcast. You're a big Vikings fan.
Yeah, big Vikings fan. Not a very good team, but, you know, always got to go Vikings.
You're a passionate fan. Let's bring in our next guest. He needs little introduction. We say hello and welcome in Dr. Bob Winter. How are you, Bob? Thanks for coming on the podcast.
Great to be on the show.
Yeah, it's great to have you, Bob. Thank you for coming on to this podcast. My first question to you is there one trend or one sort of, you know, thing that you see in junior golfers that troubles them mentally?
I would say that almost 99% of all new junior golfers are playing really the wrong game. They're playing the game of who's watching me and what's my score. And those two things right there just add a lot of pressure. They add a lot of expectations, because when you and I come in from a round of golf, Ryan, people don't ask us, hey, did you stay emotionally composed out there? They don't ask that. You know, they ask the question of how'd you do, which leads into what did you shoot? So we have a lot of focus on outcomes, results, scores, winning, and then we compare ourselves to everyone else. And all the juniors, when they step up on that warm-up tee, the practice range, they're looking up and down, and they're actually comparing themselves. They're actually positioning themselves. They're sort of putting themselves in sort of a pecking order, if you will. Oh, this player is really good. Oh, they've won a state championship. I don't know if I can play with them. And then they start asking themselves a lot of questions like, will I play well today? Will I be good enough to compete with these other players? When am I going to be good enough? And who am I paired up with today? And why is all these bad things happening to me, but this player is getting all the good breaks? So there's a lot of questions, a lot of doubt that actually just pervades the junior golfer's mind.
Dr. Bob, I understand how expectation could certainly hurt a junior golfer, but how do you tell them not to have expectation?
You know, that's the big thing, because, you know, that's that peer pressure, that social judgment, the social evaluation. They're always looking around and talking about, I'm going here, I played well here. They have their iPhones. They're always checking their junior golf scorecard rankings, things like that. But we have to understand that even though we have a support team, the main support team for every player when they go out to play is made up of three people. And every junior golfer that I work with that actually goes on to play college or professional golf, they understand this from a very early inception. And that is, it's me, myself, and I. And I've always said, if it is to be, it has to begin and end with me. And the support teams, the coaches, the parents, we all want our sons and daughters to play well. We do, but we can't want it any more for them than they have to want it for themselves. Because out there, you are psychologically and physiologically alone. It's your game. So you're either the champion or either you're the GOAT. And I don't mean the greatest of all time. So yeah. That's one of the beauties of the sport. But this is a tough and brutal game. And if you don't learn these lessons, the lessons of letting go of expectations and getting into playing your game, the game of golf will smack you down every time. No matter how much you're trying, how much you want it, you have to learn these lessons, and you've got to learn them well.
Dr. Bob, I've seen a lot of issues between parents and their children in all sorts of youth sports, especially in golf. When you see this sort of situation, how do you first deal with it?
Sit down and talk with a junior player. I will include their parents as well. So I'm just not coaching and helping, you know, the student athlete. I'm sort of coaching the parents as well. So we can actually have a personal playing philosophy for this player, meaning, and I want my players to understand, I want your parents there. I want your coaches there, because this is such a short window. And they are there because they are invested in you. And for parents on the sideline, they have the toughest job in sports, because they can't say anything. They can't give, you know, hand signals or anything else out there. And they see their son or daughter, they see them three putting, they see them, you know, sort of chunking shots. And the biggest thing they have to do is stay sort of stoic. They have to stay very emotionally calm. And for a lot of parents, that's tough to do, because they have so much invested, just not, you know, personally, but financially, time investment. And they really are doing a great job. So the first thing I always tell the parents is, when you have your performer, they are the star. They're out there on the golf course. You're just a support team. And you have to provide unconditional support, whether times are good or whether times are bad. And I've always loved what Tiger Woods' parents, you know, gave him. They gave him the freedom to succeed. They also gave him the freedom to fail. And then when he did fail, Earl and Katita would actually take the time to let him decompress. And then when he was open, he would say, Daddy, Mommy, what did I do? You know, can you help me? And because now you're allowing them to come to you, you're not hovering over them, you know, and screaming at them in the car saying, why did you do that on number 12? And right. One of the things, we're just giving them, you know, some room to sort of decompress, to sort of understand that they are the performer. And that's the big thing about parents and coaches. We have to realize from a very, very early start is that we're just a support team. This is the performer. So when I talk to my junior players and they, you know, are asked, why did you hit that shot on number 12? I want them to be able and confident enough to give their coaches and parents an answer, because they say, this is the way I saw it. This is the way I felt I needed to hit it. And I did it. It's my choice. And they have to be very comfortable with playing their game, not playing, trying to please mom and dad and the coaches. But in the end, this is a game about pleasing yourself, because you're playing for yourself. And here's another thing, Ryan, that you asked me at the very beginning here, is that I think so many players go into a competition of 144 kids thinking that they have to beat 143 people. The competition isn't the other players. Because if I'm playing against you in tennis, that's direct competition. I win by making you lose. Golf is a parallel competition. We're all performers out here playing on a field, and it's the golf course, the game. That's the ultimate competitor. And it is a solid, tough competitor. And like Las Vegas, the odds are always in its favor. So you have to understand going in that this is sort of an unfair game, even though it's the greatest game ever invented. But you have to use every means possible to give you a performance edge. So instead of actually thinking I have to beat all these kids, you have to beat the golf course. And you have to fall in love with wanting to play your game the way you see it, you know, and let everyone else go. And when you do that, that puts you in the zone, what I call the zone of personal control. Because all you can do is all you can do, but all you can do should be more than enough if you're actually confident and know that your ability will come through.
Dr. Bob, you've worked with some of the best players in the world. Is there a certain mental trait that they all share that really separates them from the competition?
They are full of grit, determination, passion, and a lot of times they're stubborn and they're skeptical. And I want my players, you know, to sometimes to question me, why are we doing this? Why are we doing it this way? Because if you're always amenable and you're always sort of taking, you know, suggestions willy-nilly, it's almost as if anybody can come up in the range and say, you know, what's going on with your putting stroke? What's going on with your swing? If, you know, someone else can introduce doubt in your mind, they've already got control over you. So I think it's really important with the great players I've had over the many, many years. I'm talking the Justin Roses, the Brooks Koepkas, the Tony Finaus, and even the Michelle Wees and Lydia Kos that we've had at the Ledbetter Golf Academy. All of them have sort of this little healthy skepticism that says, okay, why am I doing this? And then when you convince them or they convince themselves, this is the right procedure, this is the right philosophy, they are all in. And I think that's the one trait that they all have.
How about emotion, Dr. Bob? Some show it, some don't. You think about Tiger Woods, John Rahm, super emotional out on the golf course. Others like DJ and Brooks Koepka, very stoic. Where are you with a junior golfer showing emotion, being emotional out on the golf course?
Talk about junior golfers having the fire in the belly. And sometimes we say, I don't want you to show any emotion at all. We're not trying to make them automatons. We're not trying to make them lifeless human beings. I like to see a little bit of fire. I like to see someone get upset. When I played, and I have played at every competitive level, when I lose, I hurt a little bit. I want them to, you know, be a little bit upset. That doesn't mean that they have anger run amok, but I want them to sometimes say, okay, I need to kick myself in the butt here a little bit, or pat myself on the back. And that's sort of a nice emotional balance right there, to know when to turn up the volume and when's just sort of, you know, to sort of hold on here. I need to be a little bit more stoic. But it's different strokes for different folks. And I think, you know, a lot of times you'll hear parents say, well, I could never tell my son or daughter, I can't tell whether they're four over or four under. And I sometimes look back and we get down, sit and talk about it, is that as if they're like at Halloween wearing a mask. But even though they're not showing the emotion, are they emoting inside? And a lot of times players are imploding inside. They have so much anxiety. They have so much performance distress that you don't see it. But they've gotten very good at being blank. So for me, I like to keep, you know, the fire stoked. But it's like cooking a steak. You want to cook it, you know, at the right temperature. If you cook it too hot, you're going to burn the steak. You don't, you know, cook it enough, that it never gets done. So it's a nice balance that, you know, we have to work, you know, with our junior players.
Dr. Bob, I know quite a few junior golfers that are, I guess you could say, professional practicers. They just look like absolute pros on the range. You know, they're striping it all the time, but they get to the course and they can't break 80. So what do you say to these players that are so great on the range but can't take it to the course?
Talking about performance anxiety and, you know, personal perceptions of pressure, and let me give you a definition, Ryan, of what pressure really is. I think it's a good one made by a researcher named Bowmeister. He said, pressure is a factor or any combination of factors that increases the importance of me wanting to perform well. Now, that's a great definition because what it says, it could be one factor or a number of factors. But when we start talking about the value of something, something's really important to me, you're increasing the importance of that situation. So perceived value and your perception of the event. You know, what we're trying to do is get, you know, players to understand the reason why you're warming up, the reason why you're practicing, you know, so much is so that you can go out and perform. We always talk about training, what you train, and then go out and trust it. But for me, I always knew that there was a disconnect there. going from the driving range to the golf course. So for me, in my practice, what I'm working with all of my players, all of them, whether junior, collegiate, or tour player, is this transfer element. So when you're warming up, when you're playing recreationally or just by yourself, make it as real. Simulate it as much as you can to actual hitting golf shots. And I see, you know, junior players warming up with the alignment sticks. They're doing all of their aids, their putting aids. You know, does that translate to real performance? Well, you see it sometimes on tour, but to me, that's more practicing. So warm up needs to be a model of you just getting yourself mentally, physically, and emotionally ready to play golf. And the big thing I'm working with all my tour players, when they talk about play, let's not go out there and work our game. Let's play golf. I love the acronym PLAY because it means perform like a youth. We have to be childlike. We have, you know, to be able to say to ourselves, everything's going to, you know, work out when we get to the first tee. What happens with most players, by the time they get to the first tee, they're saying, this is so important to me. I have to play well. I must. I should. And then, you know, they self-sabotage because they are sabotaged by the tyranny of the shoulds and the have to and the must. Instead of that, you have to say, I'm looking forward to a great day and I'm going to give myself permission, this emotional freedom to go out and play as well as I can play. And let's see what the day brings. Create your day is really what I always tell my players.
Good answer, Dr. Bob. Let's take this to three different kinds of players that you've coached. Let's take a major champion, a college player that you've helped, and a junior player. How different are these three players when it comes to their mental game?
Let me give you one that I've actually, you know, worked with. You know, when he's a junior, he was in college, and he went on to become, you know, number one in the world. Let's talk about Brooks. Brooks, when I first met him, I asked him, I said, what do you want to be? You know, what's your dream goal? He goes, I want to be, you know, number one player in the world. And the point of it was, he said that at that early stage. And so anytime, you know, I always ask that when a player asks me, what's your dream goal? I mean, you hear, I want to be on the PGA Tour, LPGA Tour. I want to be the best in the world, you know, but then you have someone, you know, like Brooks. And from a very early age, we always talked about it's about you, your ball, and your target. And it doesn't matter about anyone else. So you get into sort of this singular focus. And I think what happens, and everybody says, well, you're going to get to the next level, the next level, the next level. And I always do this. I go, here it is. Here's really what it's all about. It's getting comfortable in your own skin. We're talking about a level of comfortability, a level of trust, a level of composure that each one of us has. And we gain that through experience. And there is absolutely no substitute for tournament experience because we're always learning something, good, bad, or indifferent. We're always learning from some of these successes and we're learning from our failures. But when you start talking about who makes it, who gets to the next level, I think it's, you know, the player who actually believes that they belong there and they actually work. And they actually, either consciously or subconsciously, they just say, I belong there. I'm every bit as good as anybody out here. And then they look in the mirror and they go, why not me? And then they make that choice. And next thing you know, boom, they're off to the races. And it's amazing, you know, what the human genius and athletic potential that we have. I think so many times, you know, this game beats us down and we sort of look around and go, huh. Gee, I just don't know if I'm good enough. The great, you know, short game teacher, Dave Peltz, played for Indiana University. And he said made him go into NASA and engineering and all of that rather than professional golf. He said, I was playing sort of this chunky guy from Ohio State named Jack Nicklaus, and I can never beat this guy. So he said, I guess, you know, I better go in a different direction. Little did he know at that time, he was the greatest golfer of all time. And he was trying to compare himself to him. So the biggest thing, you know, for all, you know, parents, coaches, and junior players is, hey, if you've got a dream, you've got a passion, let's go. Let's have fun. Let's go out and actually create our reality. And let's do it one day, one shot at a time. And that's really, I think that's the secret to really getting from one level to another level.
Dr. Bob, a lot of times golf can be an overbearing sport for these junior golfers. What do you tell a player who doesn't look like he's having any fun?
That's where I always talk about fun. It's the first three letters of the word fundamental. I said it was fun. Then you went, duh. Then it went mental. You know, my mind, I got lost in the stinking thinking, right? So the point of it is that when we get involved in the game, we love to hit it, chase it, and find out, hey, we're pretty good at this. And then as we go along, just the stages of learning, people go, well, if you really, you know, started getting serious about this and really start working at it, you could get pretty good. Now, that naive or innocent confidence was now sort of taken back a couple of steps. Now you're thinking, gee, I'm really not as good as I thought I was. And so now I've really got to work hard. So we've taken the fun and that, you know, was just about playing the game and really getting very good, you know, at some things. And now we're working so hard. And now we're in this training mindset. We're always working. And it's funny, at, you know, the Ledbetter Academy or any academy across, you know, the United States that I've been to, you always ask players up and down the line, you know, what are you working on? What are you working on? I've never seen anybody just sitting down and going up to them and they're relaxing, go, what are you doing? You know, and I would love for them to say, I'm trusting. I've got it. Everything's going to work out. I'm just enjoying the sunshine. You never really hear that. It's always, we're working, working, working. So what happens is that we have replaced fun with this whole notion of, I've got to keep my nose to the grindstone. I've got to work long hours. And usually what that gives you is a bloody nose and baggy eyes and stuff. So the game, we have to understand, it's about enjoying your journey, enjoying your process. And for some players, they love, you know, to hit a lot of balls. Others, you know, love to play. But the biggest thing is, when the red flag of the tournament goes up, are you ready? Do you really believe in your talent? And do you believe it on the first tee? Because I've said this many times, the word believe, in the middle of that word believe is the word L-I-E. If you don't believe that you're the hottest thing since sliced bread taking off in that first tee, then it's all just a lie. And the funny thing is, Ryan, that you and I know, we played golf for a long time, the golf ball always knows what's going on up here and in here, and it reflects it in the external world. When you step into the golf shot and you know you're going to hit a good shot, almost 9 times out of 10, you're successful. But 9 times out of 10, if you know you have doubt and you're not sure, that golf ball can go anywhere. So, you know, this is a game about having a directed and focused mindset. And the more that you can give yourself, you know, a specific direction, I always talk about KISS, K-I-S-S. That doesn't mean keep it simple, stupid. It means keep it simple and specific. Simple thoughts with a specific target. If you can get into your stuff and play your game and dismiss everyone else, that's when the fun, that's when the magic really happens, because now you are absorbed and engaged in the process of performing. And that's really what, you know, playing golf at a high level, whether it's junior, collegiate, or tour level, is all about. And every player who comes off the golf course, whether they win, lose, or draw, and they say, hey, do you have a good round out there? They will always look at you and go, yeah, I'll tell you what, I wish I could go back out and play another 18. That was fun. And that is the goal, I think, of junior golf.
Dr. Bob, we appreciate having you on the podcast today. Certainly you've had some great advice for not only the player, but the parents that are listening. How can they get a hold of you if they'd like to use your services?
Thanks, Ryan. I can be reached at several venues. One of them is my website. That's drbobwinters.com. That's drbobwinters.com. You know, theconfidencedoctor.com. That's what I'm known internationally now, trademark, theconfidencedoctor.com, and also ledbetter.com. Those three different websites, people can Google my name, Dr. Bob Winters. It shows up. And I do, you know, phone virtual coaching. I do email coaching, Skype coaching, Zoom coaching. And I'll tell you what, I'm only just a fingertip away, you know, from help, you know, for those young students and even for the parents that might need a little bit of psychological golf counseling. So it's a tough game, but it's a great game. And I'll tell you what's really fascinating, and I'm going to tell this to all the parents and coaches. You know, one of the greatest joys you have is when your son or daughter comes up to you and they give you the biggest smile and they tell you, thank you for being there. And that could be after a good round or a bad round. But the greatest thing for parents is that you're there, you are invested, good, bad, or indifferent, but your support means everything, you know, to these young athletes. Now they may not, you know, show it, and they may show signs of disgust or that you're embarrassing me or you're making me nervous, but don't ever, you know, sit out. Always be there, you know, for your junior golfer, because that's really important. Like I say, time goes by really, really fast, and these are great moments that you can actually enjoy and participate in their success.
All right, Dr. Bob, I'm sure a lot of our viewers and listeners will be taking you up and sending you an email. Aaron, it's interesting because Dr. Bob provided so much insight into the mental game. I know that's a part of the game that you've looked at for a long, long time. So I want to start with your win this past weekend on the Florida Junior Tour. Did it all the hard work seem worth it when you were named champion again and you got to hold that trophy?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, the last few weeks and months, I've been grinding a lot in my short game. And, you know, first round, I was 3 out of 4 in scrambling. Second round, I was 2 out of 4 for scrambling, which is, I think, is really solid for me. And, you know, I made a lot of clutch par putts to the end and just mentally stayed put. So, yeah, it was 100% worth it.
And I've seen some video. I saw the fist pump. I mean, we talked about Dr. Bob about emotion. You're not afraid to show emotion out there. Where's it come from?
You know, honestly, just at that very moment, I was just really fired up. And I was just really excited that I made a clutch par putt. So, you know, I just got to keep having that those little successes, and you know, you have to enjoy them because golf is a fun game.
Well, congratulations to you on your win. Certainly want to wish you and your family happiest of holidays, and everyone out there on the A to Z of Junior Golf Podcast. Certainly we wish you a happy holidays, a Merry Christmas. We'll be back here right after the new year with the very next episode of the A to Z of Junior Golf Podcast.
And that's capo in the back, and that's woe in the back. Don't need Gucci on my back, TV Gucci got my back. Don't know where I'm at, I've been here, I've been back. In Delilah, word of Zach, I need action, that's a fact.
I style, no stylish, no Chanel, Saint Laurent, Gucci bag. I style, no stylish, Louis Vuitton, Jimmy Choo, that's on you, huh?
Koepka from 101. Great birdie opportunity here for Brooks Koepka. He delivers.
Yeah, don't call me till the check's clear. I style, no stylish, no Chanel, Saint Laurent, Gucci bag, huh? I style, no stylish, Louis Vuitton, Jimmy Choo. This on the
Koepka is doing his own thing. He's playing his own event, and he's doing it unlike anybody else.